survive, not only survive, but thrive. I believe it's because of racial and religious divisions created by people in positions of power, irresponsible people who exploit these divisions for their personal gain. It's disgusting. To reverse the current situation we are in, we must reconcile. We must overcome our differences. First thing first, we need to understand that the problem isn't the next race. We are all of one race. We are the Malaysian race. We must love each other as Malaysians. If we are determined enough to love each other as Malaysians, can the idiots who want to divide us and rule us by division, only then will they fail. And they will fail miserably. Yeah. At this juncture, it is critical that we remain hopeful. Yeah. We must have hope. We must believe. No matter how long it takes, will prevail. This is the eternal truth.
Siapa kata gadis Melayu tak melawan? Who says the legal don't fight? We are here to fight for justice. When we got our jobs, our parents would tell us, do not take what you do not own. You are answerable to the people, to the taxpayers. Your duty is first to protect the interests of all Malaysians. That is why I cannot do nothing when I know that 2.6 billion of people's money gone missing. Yeah. I cannot just keep occupied watching my fellow countrymen who are trying so hard to protect the interests of Malaysians take a pick down one by one and criminalize while the real criminal is let loose. I cannot accept that my people are starving, struggling to make ends meet, yeah, while the powers that be are dancing in luxury. Yeah. Yeah. My conscience will never let me turn a blind eye on all these injustices around me in my country. I am here not for any political party. I am here for myself, for my family, for my future family, and for my fellow Malaysians. Yeah! Someone used to say, Melayu mudah lupa. Malays can forget so easily. Let me tell you something. I am a Malay. Remember Haji Abdul Rahman Limbo.
Right.
Some may choose to brand us as anti-government or anti-establishment. But I have yet to say that we, I have yet to hear that we are here because we can. But that is the real reason why we are here. Because we care about our country. We care about our brothers and sisters.
Jamie Raja.
Asia, we have had the same ruling party as our government since independence. After all, don't we have a parliamentary democracy? Aren't the people able to vote for a government of their choice? What's gone wrong with the parliamentary democratic system in Malaysia? For a start, an essential ingredient of democracy is an independent judiciary. Now, we know that the judiciary in Malaysia has long lost its independence. Let's compare the treatment of Anwar Ibrahim with that of the Prime Minister Najib. Now, Anwar Ibrahim was found guilty on trumped-up charges, which even the expert witnesses said was tainted against him, Anwar. But still, he ended up in jail. On the other hand, we have the Prime Minister, Najib, who has admitted, who has confessed to having vast sums of money in his personal bank account, and he walks free. Now, is this fair? Is this what you call democracy? The previous Attorney General tried to issue an arrest warrant on Najib. But guess what? He was sacked. So was the Deputy Prime Minister. The current Attorney General says Najib has no case to answer. Now, this is despite the fact that the United States Department of Justice is preparing to confiscate $1 billion in misappropriated assets. Now, what do you make of this? Who is M01?
Najib!
I can't hear. Who is M01?
Najib!
So, all of our subservient judiciary, we have seen an innocent man go to jail while the guilty walk free on the streets. In a recent case, former ministers who have defected from the government spoke about corruption issues related to one MVP in Parliament. And guess what? The speakers ruled that these same former ministers have breached the Official Secrets Act.
Shame.
Talk about corruption is a secret. Everyone knows about this corruption. Take the case of Rafizi Ramli, who has been jailed, sentenced to jail for 18 months, again, on this Official Secrets Act. Now, what did he do? What dirty secret did he reveal? How did he put the country at risk? For I tell you, he had with him Malaysia. So once again, we see the innocent are jailed while the guilty go free. You know, it's like walking down the street and you see a thief snatch a handbag, and then the police come to you. Hey, what's your name? And the person who has stolen the money runs away scot-free. Now, is this fair?
No.
You know as democracy? Now, Article 10 of the Malaysian Constitution proclaims freedom of speech, freedom of assembly and association. But in Malaysia, we have a plethora of legislation that undermines those very rights. Take the case of Zuna, the cartoonist, who drew cartoons about the Prime Minister and his wife, Rosmah, is the National Security Bill. Now, this bill allows the Prime Minister to declare security areas without recourse to Parliament. So once this is invoked, the security forces can walk into this area. They can arrest anyone. They can seize property, search anything, and all without warrant. And also in absolute secrecy. Now, what sort of democracy have we got here? Does it smell rotten to you? Yes! Is this bad?
No!
Yet another threat to democracy in recent days is the emergence of a vigilante group called the Red Shirts, led by an UMNO chieftain, Jamal Yunus. Now, this group of hooligans and thugs are completely unaccountable. They work with complete impunity and with the cooperation and connivance of the UMNO leadership. Malaysians are appalled to see these wretched hooligans attack Bersih activists. The Bersih movement has gone from strength to strength. Even other political forces are now uniting together, some even allied with the former Prime Minister Mahathir, to fight for democracy. Now these people have short memories. They forget that even colonialism was defeated in Malaysia. Victory for our cause, victory for justice, victory for democracy is inevitable. And you guys here will remember this moment because you will stand up and say, I attended the Bersih rally.
Thank you.
1969, what happened? In 1969, what happened? We had an unfortunate incident called the race riots, and as a result, our country of Malaysia was under the state of emergency. Now, the Malaysia Agreement can only be suspended when it is in a state of emergency. That was the opportunity given to the Malaysian government at the time to overrule the Malaysia Agreement 1963 and took possession of all the land rights, particularly oil and gas, of Sabah and Sarawak. In 1974, as some of you will remember, in 1974, the Petroleum Development Act was passed. As a result, Petronas was formed to transfer the assets of Sabah and Sarawak into a government-owned entity called Petronas. From 1974 until now, it is estimated the oil and gas revenues of Petronas would be at least more than 1 trillion ringgit. 1 trillion ringgit. My friends, fellow Malaysian citizens, next time you visit Kuala Lumpur and you see the Petronas Tower, give thanks to the people of Sabah and Sarawak because they own and control 75% of the Malaysian oil and gas. Not from West Malaysia, but 75%. And we should acknowledge our brothers and sisters from Sabah and Sarawak because without them, Malaysia would not be what it is. Now, as I said, something interesting happened, and this is where sometimes we have to give credit for our Prime Minister, whether we like him or not. In 2011, something happened again. He repealed the Internal Security Act, and in the process, he removed the emergency ordinances. Remember I said, Malaysia was still in a state of emergency from 1969 until 2011. What he didn't probably realize, when you lift that emergency ordinances, it means that the obligation that came with the previous acts, as I mentioned, the Continental Shelf Act of 1966 and the Petroleum Mining Act of 1966 is now in void. What this means, and this is the good news for Sabah and Sarawak, the oil and gas assets is now belonging back to you. Fellow Malaysians, I think a lot of us don't even know this. Because of something happened in 2011, all that assets, as I say, the Malaysia Agreement continues in perpetuity because it can only be changed as provided all parties involved signed up to it. So as a result of 2011, all those assets belong to Sabah and Sarawak. And that's the reason why you find that now in Sabah and Sarawak there are a lot of discussions from the state government to the federal government about increasing the royalty from 5% to 20%. Right now, said to say Sabah is the poorest state in Malaysia. Sarawak is the third poorest state, and yet they have 75% of the oil and gas assets. That's the reason to it that I just mentioned. So, brothers and sisters, friends, we need to appreciate our fellow Malaysians across the border, across the sea, because many of us don't even know this has happened. And did you know one of the sad things of this disparity of distribution of wealth? There are people in Sabah and Sarawak that do not have good roads, do not have clean water, do not have electricity. Most of us in West Malaysia would take it for granted. You live in Melbourne, you have taken it for granted a long time ago. But I have been visiting Sabah and Sarawak in great time to see our fellow Malaysians still living in almost the 19th century conditions. And yet this is the country, this is the state that has 75% of the oil and gas, and they have only got 5% royalty out of it. Who in the right mind would only have 5% return on the assets that you have? Nobody. So this is a terrible change the future of Malaysia. Okay, with that, thank you so much. acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which we gather, the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation, and pay my respects to the elders, past and present. I acknowledge that we meet on stolen land, that sovereignty was never ceded, and that the struggle for Indigenous rights continues here and across the world, including at home in Malaysia with the Oral Asli. Here we are. We have a Prime Minister who's being accused by 5 different governments of embezzling something on the order of $3.5 billion. But remember, it's not just one NDB, it's lots of other things too. Investing $3.5 billion out of the country, some of it pocketing for himself. And he's come up with all these different kinds of stories, you know, including the donation from the Saudi prince. He's been actively obstructing investigations into this. He's been actively silencing criticism. And meanwhile, over the past month, and especially last night, we've had arrests. 10 so far, from the latest count. 14 updated count. There's been 14 arrests of Bursay protest leaders. There's been unprovoked raids and confiscations of the Bursay office. Malaysia Kini has been threatened. Bursay's consequence has been threatened, going into rural Malaysia and spreading the word. These red shirts, the government has allowed these red shirts to run amok. No control. Police can do nothing against them. I ask you, we stand here fighting for equality before the law. Do we have equality before the law?
No!
Say it again, do we have equality before the law?
No!
Right! Because if Najib was any other person, there would be a manhunt for this guy. 5 different countries would be after him right now. The core theme of activism, which is true everywhere, it's true for Mercy, it's true everywhere else, is that there is one rule for the rich and powerful, and one for everyone else. When we talk about equality before the law, we're talking about 2 things. We're talking about a law that should be applied equally to everyone, and we're talking about a law that should be equal to everyone. So for example, let's say Najib is someday brought to justice. What's going to happen to him? Anyone? Now, what's going to happen to him? What's going to happen to Najib? Probably not. The worst thing that will happen to him is he's going to get a jail term. He's going to get 20 years jail. That's not justice. This guy is responsible for draining our country dry. And he's going to get, 20, 30 years in prison? Not good enough, I say. Given the evidence that we have so far, any sensible person would conclude that our Prime Minister, Najib Razak, is a liar and a criminal. He's a thief! He's a thief! The government rules by our consent. We give and we take away the right to govern. We the people. If it was up to us, if Najib ever gets caught by us, we will haul him back to Malaysia and we will drain his personal accounts dry. We will put it right back into the treasury and we're going to rebuild the country with that money. We're going to spend on schools, we're going to spend on infrastructure, we're going to give welfare to the people that need it, and we are going to make Najib and his cronies watch.
Yes!
So, if we deem the government unfit to govern, how do we take the power away from them? History teaches us that everything that has ever been worth winning has had to be fought for. It wasn't won by people acting nicely. You guys remember the civil rights movement, and also when they gave the vote to women, those things weren't achieved by someone going to the people in power and asking nicely. That comes later. The first thing you have to do is you have to organize on the ground. Change comes from below. This is not simply something that's in the instruction manual for bureaucracy. It's not just a rule that we have to follow. It is the final and only guarantee of our rights. You are the final and only guarantee of the rights that you have. Do you understand that?
Yeah.
Do you understand that?
Yeah.
Look at Monash. You guys sold the Monash place, right? Monash University of Malaysia on Thursday, I think it was, shamefully told everyone, you know, if you go to the Bursay rally, we can't protect you. If you attend an illegal rally, we can't protect you. We won't be so don't go. No. And people said, no, that's wrong. It's not in the university's place to tell people that they can't fight for what's
that they had to do it for the student union. They weren't willing to release a press statement on their own.
But more than that, right? Not just that dissent gives us the power to fight back against the government, whatever the law happens to say. More than that, dissent brings us together. Look at this crowd. There's all sorts of races here. This is the kind of place where we know, where we feel, where we understand that the races do not matter. Malay, and Indian, and Chinese, and Lion Lion are here fighting together for the things we believe in. Through struggle, we understand that our interests are one and the same, and our enemy is not some other race, some other religion, it's the rich and powerful. It's not even his cronies. We need to bring back this protest culture. Before 1965, the protest was around. Malaysia had a protest culture. We were an active democracy, and it was quashed. Right? We instituted all the protest laws, and we quashed the protest culture, but it is back, because the crisis is back. The government cannot tolerate its own crisis any longer. This is the time that we stand up and we say enough is enough. We take back our country through struggle, because without struggle, there is no guarantee of democracy. And without democracy, there is no hope for our struggle. This struggle is one the same. We are united. Victory is our day. Victory is our day. Thank you for coming. Thank you, everyone.
Can we all say, Saya Cinta Malaysia? Thank you. We are here today to talk about the future of Malaysia. That's what Bersih is about. It's not a movement. It's not only a rally. It's an idea. It is a philosophy for a better Malaysia. It is about standing up for democracy, elections, and transparency. It is about Malaysia achieving its best. I want to speak to you today about how the youth can shape the future of this great country. If you look at the demographics, it is clear how youth constitute the largest growing voting group in Malaysia. Over 50% of Malaysia's population is under the age of 30. Over 20% voters in the last election, 2.6 million voters, were new time voters. This will only increase in the coming election. The young generation here represents the new Malaysia. We see the same pattern in other countries as well. The youth will play not only a role in shaping the outcome of future elections, but also the overall political transformation and culture of Malaysia. Democracy is not only a system of governance, but a culture of how we think, culture of how we conduct ourselves, and democracy cannot exist without the culture of democracy. This is where you are change makers. Each and every one of us here are change makers. And not only are we change makers, we are powerful agents of change. There are many reasons why the youth are well positioned as change makers. First of all, we are less constrained by the status quo. We are fluent in technology and increasingly connected to each other in an intertwined world. Malaysian voters and young people are more and more aware that they're getting news from multiple sources. But what I think the US elections teach us is that we also need to be skeptical of what we see in the media, and we have to discern what's the truth. We know how to ask questions. That's the young generation. We have energy. That's the young generation. Most importantly, the young generation knows how to dream. We know how to be optimistic. We know how not to give up on hope. An example of that is, if you see Canada, Justin Trudeau won, despite the conservatives, a trend there, because of the young voters. And the young voters will make a change in Malaysia. We love Malaysia! My friends, some of you may wonder, what is the use of all this? When will we see change? I want to tell you, change is a long-term organic process. I want to tell you about a great man called Mohandas Mahatma Gandhi, whom we all know. His struggle, of course, in a different context, took almost 3 decades. The same is true for Martin Luther King Jr., Nelson Mandela, and all those who have made a difference to make this a better world. I'm not saying we have to see 3 decades and wait 3 decades in Malaysia, but we must not give up hope easily. We must be patient, and without dreams, we cannot fly. Our strength is our idealism. Our strength is our dreams. As the American poet Langston Hughes said, hold fast to your dreams, for without them, life is a broken ringwork that cannot fly. We are here for change. We are here for hope. We are here that is democracy, multiculturalism, tolerance. We want top-down change, we want institutional change, but the change has to start from us. We are change makers. What is democracy? Democracy is about people. Demos from the Greek word and Plato's rule. Democracy means active citizenship and all of us to play a role there. And active citizenship requires you to play a role in changing and shaping the political system. This does not have to be complicated. It can be as simple as teaching your kids. I know many of our friends, my friend Elaine, for example, for their children. I see so many young people here. I see so many young children here. And if you can teach them the values of tolerance, the values of multiculturalism, the values of dignity, the values of compassion, the values of equality, the values of democracy, that's all we need. And you have half of your job is done. If you want to make a further effort, you make an effort for voter registration. How it could be you asking for more from elected representatives. It could also be a bit more democracy in our own lives, families, neighborhoods. It is a culture. Maybe a bit of self-reflection. This is our time to think post-race. This has to start out with us thinking beyond race, thinking beyond religion, because and this is the change that inevitably be reflected in the generational change. Let us start practicing that in our lives. We have not only a stake, but a responsibility in creating a more accountable democratic space and process. You can call for change in a peaceful way. And Bursay is the best evidence in Malaysia and in 60 capitals and cities across the world. We have shown how there can be a non-violent, peaceful protest and a campaign for democracy. Peace and peace will survive and thrive. The generational change we see is an opportunity for Malaysia. All of you can play a powerful role. As a friend of Malaysia, I'm here to show solidarity. Malaysian friends, I want to tell you that your diversity is not a weakness, but your greatest strength. The ethnic, religious, and other forms of diversity we see in Malaysia is what makes it great. I tell many of my friends, Malaysia is a country where somebody wearing a miniskirt and a hijab can sit next to each other. And not only can they sit next to each other, they can make friends. The people who came to buy the t-shirt, the people who came here today, they represent that multicultural Malaysia, that post-race Malaysia, because Malaysia can be beyond race, because that's what makes Malaysia great. I don't want to identify them by race, because we are all equal here. But I want to tell you that why my friends are telling me here, when he came to buy t-shirts, there's someone, I don't want to mention his race, because importantly, he is Malaysian. He came all the way from Geelong, 3 hours, to come to the city just to buy a t-shirt. Last time, there was a delivery. Last time, there was a delivery. Another ethnic group, I don't want to mention the other ethnic group, because we have to think for place Malaysia. And that person waited 1 hour in the train station just to pick up his t-shirt. And this is Malaysia. This is Bursay. This is our quest for better Malaysia. So I'd like to conclude by saying, let us stand together. Malaysians and Malaysian friends, for building a Malaysia that can stand tall. We live in the interconnected world, diaspora. Many of you have moved to Malaysia, from Malaysia to Australia. We can still raise awareness, we can still play a role, because we live in a connected world. And Bursay is the perfect example of that, where the international community, the diaspora, have all come together. And this is demand side good governance. Last but not least, I want to leave you with a quote from Martin Luther King Jr. You don't have to see the whole staircase, just take the first step. And he also said, only in the darkness we can see stars. So with that I conclude, and I want to conclude by saying, Sayang Cinta Malaysia!
Salam saudara saudari semenanjung. Salam saudara saudari.
leave to us again. Today I will talk about institutional reform and voters registration. We have heard my comrades talk about a host of issues and what we can do about it. I want us to come away today awakened that there is at least one thing we can do at home. The institution, as you see today, needs a lot of fixing. The Electoral Commission claims to be an independent body, but we all know the blatant influence that Barisan Nasional has over the Election Commission. Since 1955, it has been a known fact that number of seats changed have been trumped up to give an unfair advantage to Barisan Nasional. This is unfair!
Yeah.
Even just a few hours ago, Free Malaysia Today released an article on Nurul Izzah calling for a stop on the proposal of redrawing boundaries in Lembah Pantai. As we have seen, Izzah win in Lembah Pantai before. If a redrawal is to be made by changing the size of the boundaries, it would destabilize the chances of Pakatan to win over BN. This pattern needs to be changed, because this is not the first time we see arbitrarily shifts the seats up and down to fit their benefits. It doesn't fit our benefits, the rakyat who vote. The blatant gerrymandering of the EC needs to be met with public accountability. And how do we do that? I will give you some practical advice. Firstly, voting. Who here has registered to vote? Put your hands up. Who here hasn't registered to vote? Can also put your hand up. It's okay. Every election cycle, we get news of phantom voters, delineation and illegal voting, which casts doubt on the integrity of the elections. I ask of you, do not be dissuaded by this. If you go home and are planning to vote at home, go to the post office and register to vote. It only takes a few minutes. Then check at the EC website that you are rightly voting in your constituency. If you plan to vote overseas, go to your consulate and demand that they reform the overseas voting system. Right now, there is inconsistency on our system in which some embassies accept overseas voting registration and some do not. This causes confusion and unnecessary distress. As we have seen 2 months ago, students and Malaysians get to flock to their consulates to register only to be turned down. It also shows the great inefficiency in the system for something so important as our democratic right. An urgent reform is needed, and with that, Global Crusade is issuing a petition for the reform of overseas voting. The petition includes advanced and systematic voting on an ongoing basis across all Malaysian embassies. Global Crusade even takes one step further by suggesting to formally collaborate with the embassies to ensure transparency. You can go to globalcrusade.org to read more. I could put it all here, sorry. The point is, we need to do this together, and we need all hands on deck, not just today, but every day until the system is reformed.
Yeah!
Yeah! We won't stop! We won't stop! We won't stop!
Secondly, and I think this fits to the most important part that I want everyone to leave today with, is that there needs to be a consistent public awakening. A friend of mine once said that we all need to liberate our souls. We need to liberate it from the prison of oppression. The individual needs self-liberation from the corrupt and unjust tyranny. And we need to remember that there has to be a fight within us every day, together, collectively. And as a collective, you can do a lot of things. You can sign the Global Progressive Petition, join your local organization. If you are a student, we have Malaysian Progressives in Australia. While it is a shame that Malaysian universities do not facilitate this course, it becomes more of a responsibility for the student overseas.
Yeah.
To come out and join solidarity action for your brothers and sisters at home.
something is sustained, continued action. While it's one thing to wear a yellow t-shirt, come here, buy a yellow t-shirt from us, take photos, great. But that's not enough. There has to be continued action, because the situation in Malaysia now, our opposition leaders and then their lieutenants, one by one, piecemeal are being put in. So until now, we took comfort from someone else representing us, our representative MPs. They will speak up for us. But now, each of them, one by one, piecemeal, are being disassembled and put in jail. So we can no longer wait and watch. Our NGO leaders are being put in jail. Mariachin was put in jail yesterday. We can no longer sit and watch. It is incumbent upon us to make a change.